Next Sunday is Super Bowl Sunday. Go Eagles! And we will have our Super Bowl lunch with all varieties of soups. And donations will go to the Society of St. Andrews, which feeds the hungry. So be sure and come and eat and donate. Don't forget to show your support of McCoy Adult Daycare by funding Bill Sadbury's rocker for the Rockathon. That will be at 10 o'clock Saturday, February 18th at St. Mark's United Methodist Church. Mark your calendars for Fat Tuesday pancake supper, free pancake supper, starting at 5 on February 21st. Should be delicious. Finally, today is Communion Sunday. All are welcome to God's table. Also, any donations left at the chancel rail during communion will go to our Good Samaritan Fund. This fund goes directly to those in our community who are in need. Prayer concerns. Doc Cater is recovering from 2 heart stents, and I hear he's doing very well. I hear he came to Elder Bless one day. Thankfully, Doc's son and granddaughter are both doing well after the kidney transplant. Does anyone have any pressing concerns to share? Then let's prepare our hearts as the light of Christ meets us this hour. Please stand as you're able for the call to worship. We are called to bring new understanding of God, that God so loved the world. We are the salt of the earth. We are called to bring new hope in God, that God gives us new life.
We are the life of the world.
We are called to follow the commitments and the law.
The law of God is to love God and to love one another.
Come, let us be the salt of the earth and the light of the world.
Come, let us love one another with the love of God. Let us join together in our love of God to worship and follow Jesus.
Remain standing for our next hymn.
Laying on the everlasting arms.
seated. Let us pray. God of mystery and judgment, who has made us to be the salt and light in a tasteless and shadowed world, guide us in this time of worship. Grant us understanding and spiritual discernment so that others may see your good works through us, give you the glory, and be moved to serve you. Amen. Let us continue worshiping with our next hymn.
This time, I welcome our ushers to come forward for God's tithes and our offering.
Thank you.
Please remain standing for our scripture reading. Today we move from baptismal waters of the Jordan to the Sermon on the Mount. Hear these words. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. Love you, church. I love when we sit down as a church because we sit down. You sit down like me. When I sit down, I'm always like, oh, goodness. We're not very quiet, are we? That's okay. That's okay because Jesus tells us in the passage today that we are the salt of the earth, the light of the world. Notice Jesus doesn't say, get salty. No, he doesn't say, light up. He says, almost as a matter of fact, you are salt. You are light. If you're like me, I can't help but wonder, when did that precisely happen? When did I become all of a sudden light? When did I become salt of the earth? Well, we know this from Jesus as he explains this. He says, we became the salt and the light the moment we decided to follow Jesus. It was then that something changed in you, in me, in all of us. You are the salt. No questions about it. You are the salt of the earth. You are the salt that gives people a taste of the kingdom. You are the body of Christ on earth. Whether you like it or not, you are. This is what Jesus says. You are the salt. You are the light. This is our new reality, my friends. This is our reality. This is our power. And perhaps most of all, this is our responsibility. Jesus chose this imagery of salt and light because there is so much good that comes from them. Not just French fries from McDonald's, but so much more. I've heard pastors list point after point after point of all the many benefits of salt and light. And I'm sure you've sat through those sermons, so I'm not going to go through them all. I'm going to assume that you know them already. However, there's one point that I'd like to share this morning, one point that I think we might fail to remember, and that is this. Both salt and light do not exist for themselves. Salt and light do not exist for themselves. Take light, for instance. It isn't about getting people to look at the light. People go blind when they look at the light. You can ask anyone who's gone blind from looking at a solar eclipse. It's not a very smart thing to do. The focus is not for me to stare at the lights. It's for me to use the lights to see you. When we try to become the focus of attention, when we lights try to become the focus, when we try to take center stage in life, we aren't being good lights. We aren't. The light is there to help people find their way. It's meant to shine a path, to reveal the hazards ahead. It's about getting people where they need to go without much detours. This is what a good light does for others. This is what a good light does. And salt. Salt on its own, for its own sake, is really not a great thing. If you are wondering this, just go home and take a swig of your salt shaker and tell me I'm wrong. It's just not very good. But as an enhancer, as a preservative, salt is invaluable. You know, in Jesus' day, it was common practice for farmers to salt their fields in order to get the right mix of minerals to help the plants grow. The Bible word that we see translated here for earth is also ground or dirt. You are the salt of the ground. You are the salt of the earth. Not a fun job to get dirty for Jesus. But this is our job, not to be the center of attention, but to actually help people grow. To help those around us grow. We are behind the scenes kind of people. We're not there for ourselves at all. But we're there to help people be transformed into the likeness of Jesus Christ. What Christ tells us in the Gospels is quite simple. He says, good news, the kingdom of God is near. It's near. And I'm your king, and you are my followers. You are my followers, and you have tasted and seen that this new kingdom is good, and you have decided to follow me. And because you did this, your life has changed forever. Your life is not the same. Your life is different. Your life is built now around leading others to this kingdom. This is what your life is about. If you've ever wondered what your calling really is, your calling is to lead others to the kingdom that Jesus brings to all of us. You are here not for yourselves any longer, but for the sake of the world. As Jesus says, you are the salt, you are the light. You will lead others to taste and see that the Lord is good, that this new kingdom is good. You will show them what life looks like under Christ's reign, not the world's reign. This is your calling in life. You will show people Jesus. At a previous church of mine, it was a Baptist church, forgive me. it was a Baptist church, and it was common practice for us as ministers to say after someone was baptized, we would tell them these words, you are the salt and you are the light. But we didn't just stop there. Whenever we said the words, when we said you are the salt, we would take salt, actual salt, and we would dip it on their lips so that they would catch a taste of the salt's flavor. And the same goes for the light. When they were baptized, after they were baptized, they would receive a candle, and we would light their candle. And that candle would leave the baptistry and go out into the congregation and into the world. I love this imagery because it reminds us, this is an important reminder for us as Christians, because sometimes we as Christians only see faith through a personal lens. We only see our faith as beneficial to me. But our faith is meant primarily for others. It's not just for us. When we die to ourselves, when we accept a new life in Christ, we are accepting a charge. We are accepting a calling, a mission, a calling that's much bigger than ourselves, which is to go and bring new life and light into the world. We are taking on a task. We are not only taking on a task, we are being transformed into that task, into the light, into the salt. Yeah, it's risky. It's a risky calling to abandon ourselves for the sake of others. We've all been burned sometimes for doing so. It is a loud and noisy world out there, and we might be safer just to keep our heads down, to stay focused only on ourselves. But we can't. We mustn't. Jesus tells us that too. He says, a city built on a hill cannot be hid. This is a reminder that we, as the light, are exposed. We're vulnerable. We're vulnerable to the world around us. We're vulnerable when our life is in service to others. Author Gary Thomas, founder of the Center of Evangelical Spirituality, writes in a journal, he says, when him and his wife prayed extensively about buying a house, they gave God many opportunities to close the door. God appeared to bless their move, and so they decided to make a big move. However, 5 years later, their house was worth considerably less than what they paid for. His wife and him kept asking, why did God not stop us from making this decision? How could God put us in such a bind? After all, we had given God so many opportunities. But you know, one day his wife was praying and she sensed God asking her, have you ever considered the possibility that I wanted you in that neighborhood to minister rather than boost your financial equity? Have you ever wondered that I placed you there not for your own benefit, but for the sake of those around you? You know, sometimes we get so wrapped up in our faith and how it affects our life. But at the end of the day, your faith is not primarily about you at all. Your faith is about something much bigger than you. It's about the world and transforming it into the likeness of Jesus Christ. That is what Jesus is saying here. You are the salt of the earth. Why not help things grow? Why not do your part? This is your duty. This is your opportunity to serve the Lord wherever you are. You are the light of the world. Why not help folks find their way? Why not be a good light for people? Why not mentor? Why not lead? Why not be what you are, which is a sign of Christ's presence in the world? Get out there, Jesus says. He says, get out there. That's basically what he's saying. Get out there and be who you are. Be who you are because this world desperately needs you, because I have commanded you to go. But most of all, this is what you are designed to be. You are the light. And when you aren't shining for others, your life is incomplete. When you aren't the salt, when you aren't bringing flavor and bringing life to others, then you are living an unfulfilled existence. Friends, this is who we are. And so go and do as the Lord commands you. You are the salt. You are the light. I invite you to stand with me as we say together this creed that unites us in our faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you now to lift up your silent confessions to God. Friends, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, Lord, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took the bread. He broke it. He gave thanks to you, Father, and gave it to his disciples, saying this, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, Father, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite our servers to come forward. The table is set. You are invited. Won't you come? Thank you. Will you join me in our prayer of thanksgiving found on page 11 in your hymnal? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. Amen. Won't you stand as we sing together? You might not know these words, but you'll definitely know the tune. So just listen and you'll catch on. All right, let's sing together hymn number 581, Lord, Whose Love Through Humble Service.
Lord, whose love through humble service bore the weight of human need, who upon the cross forsaken offered mercy's perfect deed. We, your servants, bring the worship, not of voice alone, but heart. God's creating to your purpose every gift that you impart. Still your children wander homeless, still the hungry cry for bread, still the captives long for freedom, still in grief we mourn our dead. As our Lord, your deep compassion healed the sick and freed the soul, use the love your Spirit kindles still to save and make us whole. As we worship, grant us vision till your love's revealing light, in its height and depth and greatness, dawns upon our quickened sight, making known the needs and burdens your compassion bids us bear, stirring us to tireless striving, your abundant life to share. Called by worship to your service, forth in your dear name we go. To the child, the youth, the aged, love and living deeds to show. Hope and health, good will and comfort, counsel, aid, and peace we give. That your servants, Lord, in freedom, may your mercy know and live.
Amen. Before we go, I wanted to mention two things. One, I hope you all know that when I make jokes about Baptists or Catholics or Episcopalians or whatever, it's merely for the joke. It's not to make fun of any group. We're all in the same church as far as I'm concerned. So I want y'all to know that sometimes I joke, and I don't know if some people don't get my sense of humor or might think I don't have a sense of humor, which might be true. The second and more important thing is I wanted to celebrate something that Mike Lindholm has put together, and I want you to pay careful attention to the bulletins coming up, and this one too. We will have a Did You Know section, and this Did You Know section will highlight a special fact about our church, our congregation over the years. In honor of the anniversary, we have put these in our bulletin, so just look at it. I might even check with you, see if you know the answer. So anybody know the answer to this question? Louise Chapman and G.L. Anthony were founders of PG Methodist. Each family still has ancestors in our church today. Can you identify any of them? Mary Melba, possibly. And Virginia Johns. Isn't that neat? That's so cool. Well, we're going to keep listing these, but also Mike has put together a fabulous, should we call it a book, or I don't even know what to call it. It's awesome. It's really neat. It's a collection of stories of history of our church, and we'll get that together, and you'll get your own free copy. So we're excited to share that with you in the days ahead, okay? But I wanted to share that just because it's so neat. It's a neat idea. All right, well, receive this benediction. Depart now in the fellowship of God the Father, and as you go, always remember, in the goodness of God you were born into this world, and by the grace of God you've been kept all the day long, even until this very hour, and by the love of God fully revealed in the face of Jesus Christ, you are being redeemed. Amen.